Aren't you glad His grace is daily sufficient?
Amen.
It's just like in the children of Israel when they were going through across the wilderness, and they got every morning God would rain down manna. Just enough for today.
Amen.
You know, I think God does that, and we know He did that with the children of Israel so that every day they'd look to Him. By the way, they had no other option. When you're following a cloud, you're not planting crops. You're not going to go work at the factory and then stopping at the grocery store on the way home. You just got to wait on God, and He's trying to teach us to do the same. Brother Rich, could you grab my iPad for me? Thank you. I left that over there, and you might want me to have my notes tonight. I only have 3 pages. I normally have 14, so my family knows what that means. We will have some testimonies tonight, so each of the different ministry leaders, be prepared, because I'm, and then some of you that aren't leaders that maybe I just asked, and we love you, Liz. We really do. I came, heard just, I think it was handshaking time. Say, hey, Liz. It's all right. There's some others in this room don't know they're getting called up yet, so at least you have a little bit of warning. Amen. Let's take our Bibles and let's open it anywhere. It's all good. But if you want to be where I'm going to be, let's go to 2 places, Ephesians chapter 4 and 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Ephesians chapter 4 and 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We'll read in Ephesians first, and then we'll go to 1 Corinthians. We read some of these verses this morning. I did not complete the passage that we started this morning. Ephesians chapter 4. We'll begin. Well, let's start clear back in verse number 7. We'll start there. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive, and he gave gifts unto men. Now he that ascended, what is it, but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? And he that descended is same also that ascended far up above all heavens, that he might fill all things. And he gave some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith, and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up into Him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacteth by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, making increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. Let's pray and we'll get right into the thought for tonight. Heavenly Father, as we come to the Scriptures, we do need Your help. Holy Spirit, I pray that You would take the Scriptures that are read, the thoughts that are given. I pray You'd use those to help us as believers understand where we are and what we're doing and what Your plan is for us as a group of people together in a local church. So I pray You to help me as I speak. I pray You'll be with those that will give testimonies in just a little while. May You use everything that's said tonight to help each of us as a believer. And then as we tonight have the opportunity to commit to some ministries, may we realize the future impact that'll make in the area around us and the lives of people that You've placed us here to minister to. So I pray You'd help us tonight as we study, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The book of Ephesians is one of my favorite books of the Bible, and this particular chapter is one of my favorite because it's so practical about ministry. God is talking about here that in verse 7 that every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Aren't you glad God's given each of us something that can help somebody else? We'll see that when we get to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Brother Scott, knock both, or take, raise the temperature on both of those 2 degrees, if you would. We're still experimenting with our heat and air, so just bear with us on that, okay? So just raise those two temperatures up, 2 degrees. Thank you. But we see here he says, every one of us is given grace. You know, we look at somebody else in ministry sometimes and we say, well, I can't do that. Well, you're probably right. But there's something you can do. I mean, yesterday when we came in and Brother Lipka had that piano torn apart in, I don't know how many pieces, but there was stuff everywhere. It was orderly. I mean, he acted like he knew what he was doing. I don't know if he did, but he faked it really well if he didn't. But I come over there and there's keys laying there. And the hammers. I'm like, okay, this will be interesting. Glad we got the electronic keyboard over there. You didn't try to rip that apart, did you? Okay, you left that one alone. Heather just went, whew. But, you know, when you hear any of our instrumentalists sit down and play the piano, I can't do that. I mean, I might do chopsticks, but I'll probably mess that one up. All right? And to hear our soloists, the different ones that sing, I praise God for that. And I was joking with Heather a little while ago, you know, that you know, she said I was going to sing a duet with her. I said, well, I don't know the song. She said, I don't either. And I knew better than that because I'd heard her practice it. You know, there are gifts that God's given different people. Where's Brother Chris? There he is. Brother Chris Coleman's been helping around here, and he can fix anything. He really can. The guy is an amazing guy. And remember I talked about Wednesday night, the one piece of plumbing that needed finished, and nobody would let me touch it? He took care of it yesterday. Hallelujah. And so we didn't have to hire a plumber to fix what I messed up. It's a good thing. I just stayed away from it and left that with somebody that God gave them that grace. He did not give that to me. Amen. But here the Bible's telling us that he's given us this measure of grace, a gift of grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. And then he goes down to verse number 11 and says he gives some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists, some pastors and teachers. I like that verse because I'm in that one. Amen. And he's talking about in churches, God has given churches. Now, some he gave apostles. We don't have any more of those. And some prophets. And it depends on your definition of what a prophet is. Some define a prophet as somebody who foretells the future. Others are just those who foretell, who tell what the book says. And I'm okay with either definition. Evangelist, okay, I know about those. We've already had one of those preach at our church. I was one for a long time, so I'm kind of partial to those. Pastors, I get to do that. And teachers. He says God gives us those. Why? Verse 12, for the perfecting of the saints. Here's what he's trying to teach us. God gives us leadership so that we as a believer can become a mature believer. So we don't stay a baby. That we grow. We joke about some of these kids that are growing. We were talking about Eli this morning. Man, the kid is getting big. Good night. And you know, our kids, when they grew up, we found as long as you feed them, they keep growing. So we'd hide the food, but they'd find it. My dad threatened to put a padlock on the refrigerator when I was growing up. I'm serious about that. We weren't allowed to eat between meals. We weren't allowed to go snack in the refrigerator. Dad had a fast rule about that. So what'd you do? I bought snacks and hid them in my room. That's what I did, amen. He didn't say I couldn't do that. He just said I couldn't go in there. And I never asked him about the other. But anyway, and don't go calling dad, all right? But here the Bible's telling us that each one of us, we have these different gifts, and the purpose is for the perfecting of the saints. So we grow up, so we become mature for the work of the ministry. So every member of the church gets involved in part of the work. Amen. Now, the book of Ephesians was not written to a pastor. It's written to a church, a local church, the church at Ephesus. Timothy was the pastor at the time. And so when Paul's writing to this church, he's telling them, here's why God has given you leadership so that the saints can be perfected so they can do the work of the ministry for the edifying of the body of Christ, meaning the body of Christ will grow spiritually and numerically. That's what happens. Right. Amen. And verse number 13, he says, till we all come to unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God unto a measure the perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, till we're like Christ. We talked about that this morning. Down to verse 16, though, says, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted, that by which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. Here God has intended that the body has a lot of parts. And He puts it together the way He wants to. And each part has a purpose. We were joking around with Bud Lipka yesterday when he had the piano all tore apart. Every part you took out of there was important. You forget to put some of those back, we'd notice it. Go to hit some of those keys and there's no hammer to hit the string, we wouldn't hear anything except the sound of that key just hitting the wood on the bottom. It had a purpose. You know, when I work on cars, I usually have a bucket of extra parts. They weren't necessary. That was just optional. Now, y'all don't want me working on your car, do you? Every part has a purpose. And for the body to be able to do what it's supposed to do, every part has to be in their place doing their stuff. Take your Bibles, go to, please, to 1 Corinthians 12. Now we'll see this again in the Scriptures, the same thought written to another church, the church at Corinth. By the way, the fact that God gives us these different thoughts and these different books written to different churches lets us know it's applicable to every church. Aren't you glad that the Bible is as up to date as today? It's practical for today. Hallelujah for that. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it's in verse number 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. You know that ye were Gentiles and carried away unto these dumb idols, even as ye were led. So the people there in Corinth, they had worshipped idols. When he's talking about dumb idols, he's talking about those that they couldn't speak. I've often wondered, what would happen if these guys pray into one of those wooden idols and it spoke back to them? That would change everything, but they're not going to speak because it just would, amen? And so he says, that's what you were. He says in verse number 3, wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God called as Jesus accursed, and no man can say that Jesus is Lord but by the Holy Ghost. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. So he's saying everybody has a gift, but they're all different. But they came from the same Holy Spirit. Verse number 5. There are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. There are diversities of operations, but it's the same God that worketh all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with all. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another the gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another divers kinds of tongues, to another interpretation of tongues. But all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as He will. Now here's what He's talking about. God's divided in the church different abilities with different people. And He's the one that chose who got what. You know, God didn't ask you what you wanted to be able to do for Him. He planned it. There are some people that God gifted certain ways. They just had that ability. You think that's nature? No, that's God. Amen? I like the way that Ron Garris used to word it. He said, it's not Mother Nature, it's Father God. That's who's in charge. Amen? And so God has divided to every man severally as He will. And he says in verse number 12, for as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, we have all been made to drink into one Spirit. For the body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, I am not the hand, because I am not the hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the ear say, because I am not the eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where were the hearing? Every time I read that, I just got this picture of this giant eyeball. Two little feet sticking out of it, walking around like this. I mean, just, that's what pops in my head when I read that. What's Paul trying to get across as the Holy Spirit is instructing him to say that? He's setting in mind that every member of the body is important. Look at verse 18. But now hath God set the members, every one of them in the body, as it hath pleased Him. We're going to look at several things about here, and I just want to give this thought before I get any farther. You know, as you read through this chapter, you see all the gifts, all of the abilities, when they're spoken of in the Scriptures, they're spoken of in how they are used in a local church. Think about that. Every one of these gifts, he's talking about how it is used for God in a local church. If God gave you ability to sing, he gave you that for the church where you're a member. He gave you the ability to play a musical instrument. That's for you to use at the church where you're a member. If you have abilities in mechanical work, he gave you that ability to use at the church where you're a member. Now, you may get to use that one somewhere else. Like you may be like Brother John, and we always call him when something's wrong with our car. Brother John, something smells really bad on my car, and it's thumping. And then he always has a list of questions to ask back. Amen? Now, he's got some ability there, and some of the other men in here do as well. But the point is, when God gave you a gift, if he gave you a gift to teach, now, you may do that as an employment somewhere, but he gave you that for use at the local church. If you have the ability to counsel people, he gave you that to help people down at the church. So we've got to understand that he places here, as we talked about this morning, in a local church so we can serve him and we can help others. And that's the whole idea of what he's saying. I want to give you just a few thoughts here, very, very simple out of this chapter. Look at verse number 18 again. But now hath God set the members, every one of them, in the body as it hath pleased him. First point, every part has a place. Every part has a place. He says in verse 27, now ye are the body of Christ and members in particular. God's picky. He was particular when he chose the members for our church. And he was picky when he chose your abilities that were going to be used in that local church. Every part has a place. You say, well, Pastor, that's simple. But it's amazing how many times Christians get that out of order. And churches are lacking in an area, not because there's not somebody there that can do it, but there's not somebody there who has been submissive to God to do it. I heard one preacher say it this way when he was talking about finances in a church. He said, there's enough money in our church to pay all the bills. And the preacher with him said, that's wonderful. He said, yes, some of it's in the offering plate, some of it's still in their wallet. That's right. You know, I've talked about it recently in the Bible days. When you read about a synagogue. Here's what a synagogue is. Anytime there were 10 Jewish families had 10 men, they could then have a synagogue. It means those 10 men, when they tithe, could pay for the ministry of the leader of that synagogue. And he would live on the average of what those 10 men made. That's how they had synagogues. That was the financial structure. I'm not going to get off on that tonight. It's not part of the message. Just got through that one in here, and I thought I'd run that rabbit a little bit and get some meat off of that one. Amen? But God planned it that way. And so tonight, you're here because you want to know what can we do to serve the Lord. And so every part has a place. There's a place for you here at Crosspointe Baptist Church. Aren't you glad about that? People all the time are looking for, I just wish there was some place for me to fit in. There is. It's called the local church. There's a place. God wants you to go and be a part of it. Aren't you glad there's a place God wanted you to be? Hallelujah. You know, I can't tell you how many people have asked me in the area, you know, since I moved from San Diego to Michigan, when they find out, well, where'd you move from? When they find out, I've only been in Michigan 3.5 years. I said, well, San Diego. And they just look at me like, are you crazy? Well, why would you leave there? Why would you leave that weather, 101 degrees today? Why would you do that? One word, God. I didn't move to San Diego for the weather. I moved there for a church. Why did I move to Michigan? For you people. God said so. I've had people ask, well, have you ever thought about doing anything different? No. Why? Because God said so. It's my place. I'd rather be here than any place on earth. And I mean that with my whole heart. I wouldn't want to be anywhere else. Why? This is my place. Hallelujah. Every member has a place. Look back at the second thing I want you to see, verse number 4. He says, now there are diversities gifts, but the same Spirit. He says in verse number, verse number 7, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal, for to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge, and by the same Spirit. We could read through that whole list again. Go down to verse number 14. The body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, because I am not the hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And he goes through the different parts. Here's the thought. It's in verse number 22. Nay, much more, those members of the body which seem to be more feeble are necessary. Every part has a place. Every part has a purpose. You know, in your human body, God designed it in a particular way. And every part has a purpose, whether the doctors understand it or not. I've heard doctors, well, there was no reason for an appendix. God put it there. You may not know what it is, but God put it there, so there's a purpose. Amen. And he's drawing an analogy now between your physical body and the church, the local church body, that every part has a place and it has a purpose. There's a task. We saw in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 16, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, making increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. Every part has a place and it has a purpose. And we read through the scripture, we talk about if you know the whole body were an eye or the whole body were a hand. And we laugh at that, but the truth is sometimes in our churches, I think we get that same idea. I'm going to move this cord before I trip on it. We get the idea everybody's got to be the same and do the same thing. We get jealous because we don't have somebody else's job and task. We just ought to be happy with where God put us, doing what God put us to do. Because that was the reason for which we were made. As the scripture says, what if all the body wanted to be a hand? What if that's all you had, just a hand? You wouldn't get to hear any music. You wouldn't get to see anything if it was just a hand. Aren't you glad God put all those things in you? For a church to be what it's supposed to be, every part needs to be in its place, fulfilling its purpose. That's the whole reason for tonight's service. That's what we're going to be talking about. A place that we can find in our local church where God would have us serve. I'll never forget the first day that my dad allowed me to help him in his children's ministry. My dad and I are very close. As you know, I grew up doing everything dad does. I just like every other boy, wants to be like dad. Dad did something, I wanted to do it. And dad's a magician. He's a ventriloquist. So I learned how to do all that stuff. And we'd go to all those kids' crusades. That's what he called it, the kids' crusades, his children's revivals. We'd go to those meetings. And I'll never forget when I was 13, where dad came to me before a service. And he had a little 3x5 card in his hand and had a bunch of words written on it. It had a bunch of songs listed. And he handed me that card. He said, son, you know those songs? I looked at him and said, well, sure, Dad, I do. He said, good, you're leading it in 5 minutes. Okay. That's when I became a song leader. But I remember in the middle of that service, Brother Rich, how excited I was. I got to help Dad. I got to do something Dad asked me to do. And as I got older, he allowed me to do other things in the services. And I got to be a part of that ministry. Man, that was exciting. I'll never forget the time that I was traveling with Dr. Boyd. And Dr. Boyd came to me one day during our classes and he says, Brother Doug, tonight I want you to take over the children's meetings in our tent revivals. So we'll have the meeting in there and you'll be over here with the children. Man, I was so excited. Why? Because that's something I'd been trained to do. I knew how to do it. Now I got to do it in the middle of a revival meeting. This is cool. Why? Because it was an opportunity to do that for which I had been trained. Those of you in this room tonight, many of you, you have abilities that we don't even know about. But God does, and He gave you those. Every part has a place, and it has a purpose. You know, one of the things we as a church want to do is provide our members an opportunity to have a good judgment seat of Christ. Amen. We want you to be able to stand before Jesus Christ one day and have Him say about you, well done, thou good and faithful servant. That, as I said recently, you're not going to hear well done unless you have done well. That means you've got to get involved. A servant's got to do something. Amen. And so the next thing I want you to see is verse number 24. We're into point 3 already in the message. Can you believe that, Liz? We're in point number 3. Every part has a place. Every part has a purpose. I'm going to mess you up because there's not a P for this one. Sorry, I tried. It just didn't work. Verse 24. For our comely parts have no need, but God hath tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacked. Notice that middle of the verse. But God hath tempered the body together. Keep your place there. Go back to Ephesians chapter 4. And one of you afterwards will come up with a P and it'll fit in my outline and it'll be happy and wonderful. I just couldn't think of it. Verse 16. From whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacteth by that which every joint supplieth according to the effectual working and the measure of every part, making increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. You see two things, you see the same thing in two places here. And we saw in 1 Corinthians, we saw it here in Ephesians, that every part is supposed to work with every other part. We're supposed to work together. As a church, God puts us together. Why? So we can work together. You know, that's why heaven's going to be. We're going to be doing things with other people. Some people just want to do it all by themselves and never want to be around anybody else. But God has so designed it, we need each other.
Amen.
Our daughter Sarah, 3 years ago when Becky and Alan got married, she was helping set up the platform and set up the wedding, and she just took a step on the platform and her ankle snapped. I mean, all kinds of tendons and all the parts that were inside that ankle were no longer working together. In fact, that some of them weren't even attached. Two surgeries. Her second surgery, the doctor, when he was looking at that, noticed part of a tendon that was not attached. One of the tendons had come loose from the bone. And it was there in the first doctor's examination, but he missed it. And wondered why she couldn't walk right. Well, when the parts aren't working, you're not going to be able to do what you're supposed to. It works that way. As I've gotten older, one of the most difficult things for me to do now is my knees don't work like they're supposed to. I have early onset arthritis in my right knee. The cartilage flakes off the bone at the end and it grinds in the joint. It's a wonderful thing when that happens. It feels so good. What happens is the knee quits working. I'm going to preach on this before long. I'm working on a message. But the hardest thing for me physically to do is to kneel. And then to get back up from that. My knees don't like it. You'll see me when I kneel. You'll always see me. I'll put my arm on something and push myself up. Why? Because my knee won't do it. Spiritually speaking, it's the same way. Hardest thing I do spiritually is kneel. There's a sermon there. Amen. Not going to go down that road tonight. But what happened? The parts aren't working. You know why churches struggle? There's some parts not in their place, not fulfilling their purpose, working with the other parts. That's what tonight's about. To help us find our place so we can fulfill our purpose, so as a body of believers, we as a church can accomplish what He had in mind for us. I don't know about you, but that excites me that God was so careful and thought so much about this church that He chose each individual and placed them here, and then we got to be a part of that. What an amazing God to have that kind of attention to detail. I love to study nature. I love to study the trees and the plants, and I love to look at plants and see how God put them together. It's absolutely amazing. I mean, you look at the wings of a butterfly. Figure that one out. And how that they match left and right. And that started out with this little thing crawling on a twig and spun this little cocoon and out pops a butterfly. That's the great designer, our God. He put that together. That's the same God that built this church, that put us together with just as much care. I'll give you one last thought here. Before we get to the testimonies, 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Look at verse number 4 once again, please. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. There are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with all. Every part is to be profitable. How is that possible? It has the power of God. Notice how many times He said it was the Spirit that was working. It was God that was working. He says there that there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. It's the same Holy Spirit that empowers the people as they play. It's the same Holy Spirit that empowers the ladies as they take care of the babies in the nursery. He said, they need the power of God. You go try to do that job. You better have the power of God dealing with those kids. I'm serious about that. You've got our future in your hands when you're doing that. You better have the power of God. Some visitor comes in, and first time they've ever put their baby in a nursery. First time they're going to sit in an auditorium and hear preaching while little junior is over in another room. You better have the power of God. You're going to need that when you deal with those parents. You're going to need that as you deal with that child. Man, that's what on Sundays I pray for the power of God all over this building. Those that are teaching the children. You need the power of God as much as I need it in here while I'm preaching. Our ushers need the power of God. As they're greeting people and helping people in, they need a touch from heaven as they're doing that. When our musicians come to sing, we don't want talented professional musicians. I want folks that are filled with the Spirit of God. The rest of that God will take care of. And I think you ought to work at whatever you do. You ought to work hard at it and practice and prepare. When I hear these folks sing and I hear those that play the instruments, I'll tell you what I appreciate at the time when I'm listening. I appreciate the hours spent preparing for that because they didn't just sit down and wing it. Hours spent. I loved it today when I came in and I was sitting in the little area I'm using as an office and I could hear the choir practicing. I loved it. Brother Picard, they weren't singing the whole song. They were working on parts. Because in a couple weeks, they're going to sing that song. And they want to do it the best for the master. So what were they doing? They were working to make sure what they were doing was the best they could do for their God. I thank God for that. But while we're doing the practice, let's be praying for His power. Because we need that from God. He says in verse 7, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. Every one of us need God's power as we do what we do for God. Tonight we're calling this ministry involvement night. Why? Because we want you to be involved in the ministry. There's so much to do. We get the idea, well, the preacher, he's the only one in the ministry. No, every one of us are in the ministry. If we've been saved, His intent was to put us in the ministry. You may not get paid to do what you do here at church, but God intended for you to do it. We've got this warped idea of what full-time Christian service is. Everybody ought to be a full-time Christian. And they ought to have some task they're doing for God. And now God does specifically call individuals to what we call full-time ministerial service. I'm in the ministry as a pastor not because that was a career choice. It was a calling of God. God instructed me, that's what I want you to do. I thank God for that. As I said earlier, I wouldn't want to do anything else in the world. There's not a single job I'd trade for. None. Why, this is what God made me for. I love it. I can't believe I get paid to do what I get to do. I get paid to read my Bible, pray, work with people, plan stuff for church, go soul winning. Hallelujah. Man, it's better than any job you can have in the world, from my perspective. But wherever you're sitting, whatever it is you do, if you know God put you there, you ought to be just as happy about it. And there's so many scriptures we could look at tonight. But that's all the scriptures I'm going to look at for now. Guys, we're going to go back to the pulpit mic, and then we'll see what happens from there. Amen. As we were talking about ministry involvement tonight, I wanted us to kind of go through some of our ministries. In fact, I'm going to have you do something that we don't hardly ever do. Why don't you grab your bulletin? Now, we didn't list all of our ministries in here. I just put down a bunch. I know I forgot some. I've thought of several since then, but I threw some down here. And we put a list, and they're not in any particular order. I had somebody ask me this morning, why are they in that order? Because I had to make the two columns fit and squeeze that into that page because I am long-winded when I write. No, I know you would be shocked. I know that would be surprising to all of you. You don't see these articles before they're edited. Because some of them, this is like, I think this one is 8.5 point type. Some of them would have to be 4.5 point type to get them on the page. And so we have to cut stuff out. That's where you get the part one and part two that you see once in a while. That's why that is. Because somebody's very long-winded. I don't know who that would be. It's Brother Rich when he's doing the prayer request. That's what it is. We talked about that this morning. We've got some ministries here, and I'm going to just pick some in random. I don't have these in an order that's any systematical thing, but we have a lot of different areas that people serve in our church. And that was a horribly constructed sentence. In the middle of it, I changed my thought. All you English teachers like, oh, man. At least I finished the sentence. Brother Judd, do I need to say anything else? Brother Judd's a friend of mine, pastors in Grand Rapids. He used to pastor the church at Mount Salem Baptist Church at the camp. And he never finished a sentence. He'd start off one, and then he's talking over here. But over here, and that's the way he talks every message. My wife tried to transcribe one of his sermons and said, forget it. When you learn to speak in complete sentences, we'll talk to you. Amen. So just sometimes my sentences are not in English. I'm not sure what they're in Hillbilly. That's what they are. All right, so we're going to look at some different ministries. And what we're going to do is we're just going to get some testimonies about some of them. And when you get over to the room in a little while, there's all kinds of little flyers and little information sheets. Even if you're not thinking about serving that ministry, it might be good to grab one of the sheets so you could pray for what they do. I was thinking this afternoon as I was looking through some of these, we're gonna put these together in kind of a standard format, and I'm going to put those in our new member packets so people know what we do. I got to think about that this afternoon. I thought, man, wouldn't that be good? Everybody's worked so hard to get these together. And so the first one we're going to talk about tonight is our master clubs. I'm so excited for Wednesday night. I really am. I never got to go to master clubs when I was a kid because they hadn't started it yet. But we had a program very similar to that in my home church. And every time I think about master clubs, my mind goes back to those days when I was a boy. And those we did it on Thursday night, and sometimes we did it on Tuesday night. We'd run our buses for that. We'd have sometimes 400 kids. Can you imagine 400 kids at one time and doing a children's program? It was a blast. Amen. And I still remember things being taught there. I remember a lot of the scripture that I memorized. Most of the scripture that I know by memory, I learned during those children's programs. Amen. And so tonight we're going to talk a little bit about that. Jill, she begged for the opportunity. She did. She sent me a text. She said, please, please, ask me. So Jill, come on up. She wants to give us a testimony about master clubs.
I'm going to tell a story. Once upon a time, there was a little girl, and she had an older sister. I'm going to start crying. She had an older sister, and a younger brother would come along later. And her mom and dad were moving because dad wanted to be closer to work. And so they moved to this nice little house, and she didn't know this, but God had picked that particular house for her parents to live in because it was across the street from a really good Baptist Bible-believing church. And God put them there, and she knows that now. And that little girl had neighbors that were Christians, and so they invited those children to go to church. The parents are great parents, great people, very moral people, but they didn't go to church. But they let their children go. And so when they were old enough to go, they went faithfully every Sunday, just to Sunday school, but they went every Sunday. And they grew. And one day, the little girl was in a class. I think it was fifth or sixth grade, and she had a teacher whose name was Mrs. Watkins. And Mrs. Watkins was a very nice lady, and she was a very good teacher. And she was teaching those little girls things from the Bible, and she made the things from the Bible real. And that little girl learned two things from Mrs. Watkins. And the first thing that she learned was she told a story about when she was younger. I think she wasn't saved at the time, or she wasn't right with the Lord at the time. And she had gone into a jewelry store, and she wanted to buy a watch, so she did it on credit. And she said she had no intention of paying for that watch. So she got the watch, and she didn't pay for it. And then later on, God told her that was stealing. Now, a little girl like me says, well, stealing is taking a candy bar at the store or this or that. But there's other ways that you can steal. She did go back to that store, and she made it right because she was a Christian, and she wanted to make it right. God told her that's what you need to do. That little girl learned, well, stealing isn't always stealing a candy bar. You can steal other things too. But you need to make things right and live honestly before all people. That's what you need to do. And one other thing that Mrs. Watkins taught that little girl that she remembered, she taught that girl that she had to go to a wedding, and this happened a little while ago. This is like in the 60s, a long time ago, and in a galaxy far away. And she had to go to a wedding, and it was very popular for ladies to sew their own clothing at that time. And she said she hadn't done that. And so she went to this fabric store, and she got the things, and she prayed, and she said, God, I know that you can show me how to do this. Show me how to do this. And Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. I can do all things. That teacher taught that little girl, you know, it's good for you to pray for somebody that's sick. It's good for you to pray for God to help you with a test. But how about praying for God to help you in all things, all kinds of things? If there's something that you have to do, God can help you do that. Ask him. And that little girl listened to that, and she said, wow, that's what the Bible says? That's what that means? One of the things that it means? And she took her up on it, and she began to practice that, especially as a teenager. And God led her to do certain things. One of those things was when she was looking for a job, and God, this little girl, said, God, now you, in all thy ways, acknowledge him, and you'll direct my path. So she asked God to direct her path. He did. God proved himself. God was real to that little girl because there was a teacher who taught what the Bible said and made it real, and she listened. She actually listened. Like I said, she had a wonderful home, but she wasn't taught the Bible at home. Church was where she learned, and there are our children. Most of the children that come here, you know, they learn from their parents, and they learn Sunday school, and they learn. But there are other children that, you know, this is the only time that they can learn about the Bible. And you never, never know when you're teaching a child what they're going to grab and to hold on to. This is a little selfish, but I'll take that step a little bit farther. That little girl also, as a teenager, she wanted to get married one day and have her own Christian home. She didn't have that. She had a good home, but she wanted their own Christian home. And she asked God to bring that one that he wanted for her. And you know what God did? He literally dropped that man right in front of her. And he did. And then time has passed. I think they're still married. They have like 4 kids and 7 grandchildren at the moment. But but Mrs. Watkins taught that little girl that God was real, and they taught her Bible principles, and she listened. I wonder if there's a Mrs. Watkins out here. If you have a little nugget of knowledge that you can, from God's word, that you can instill to a child, teaching a child the Bible first, talking with them and knowing that you care about them. How was your day at school? You had a birthday. What did you get for your birthday? What are you wanting for Christmas? Just taking a little time and caring. You don't know how far that will go and how long it will stay and where it will take that child. And they would hold on to that for many, many years. And of course, you figured out, I'm that little girl. I am that little girl. Very little anymore, or I'm kind of old, but I still remember those things, and I am so thankful for that teacher that took the time to teach, because I got a hold of it, and it's been with me all this time, and I use that all the time. So be a Mrs. Watkins. You do have something that you can give to a child. You can.
That's why we have master clubs. Isn't that awesome? I appreciate that. I like those kind of testimonies. During our master clubs, we have a lot of opportunities to help. We have Bible time. We have their book time. That's where we're working with the children with their books, learning verses from the Bible and things. We have game time and then other activities that we do. Of course, you know all about the race that we do every year. Looking forward to that for the Pine Derby, Pine Car Derby. That's going to be a blast. Master Club starts Wednesday night, and we can always use helpers there. Be praying about that. Let's see here. The next one we'll do, Brother Bill, Boston, Children's Church. And go ahead and do both those ministries we talked about. Just talk a little bit about that.
I thank God for the opportunity that He's given me and my wife to minister in Children's Church. I pray every week that we would be a blessing to the children, but every week they're a blessing to me. To be able to minister to them and to see them learn things from the Bible and to remember things from weeks before that they've been taught, it blesses me to know that and to see that the children are learning and growing, and I just thank God for giving me that opportunity. In Children's Church, the key verse that I've chosen for the ministry is in Proverbs 22:6. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. And that's why I believe the focus of Children's Church should be is teaching children God's word. So that way, even if they learn it at a young age, even later in life, even if they get away from church, they'll still remember those things that they were taught even as a child. There were so many times that I remember going out bus calling with my Uncle Vince, and we'd go to a house that we'd be knocking looking for new prospects, and they'd say, oh, I remember, I rode the bus to that church when I was a little kid, and then they'd start talking about all the things they learned and how they knew about Jesus. And even though they hadn't been in church for 20 years, 30 years, they still remembered the lessons from the Bible that they were taught. So we don't know who's going to cross our path in our children's ministry. So each week, we strive to teach them about Jesus and how God loves them and how He died on a cross to save their sins. So that way, even if they don't necessarily understand everything that week, you know, when we teach them, when they're older, they'll be able to understand and know that there's a God that loves them. There are several things in Children's Church we do to drive that point home. We worship God in singing. We teach the kids good Bible songs about Jesus and about, you know, it's not just about, you know, we like to have fun, but all of the songs are meant to focus and to worship Him, and kids are taught that's why we have singing, is to worship God, to give Him praises. We memorize verses. Every week we have a memory verse from the lesson, so that way they can remember that scripture and can hide God's word in their heart. And then, of course, the preaching. And I thank God for the men that come in every week on a rotation. They'll come in, and we'll have special Sundays where men will come in and preach, and I thank God for them for coming in and teaching God's word in love to these children, to let them know that there is a God in heaven that loves them and that died on a cross and saved their soul. And we do like to have fun in Children's Church. We do have games. We do have you know, fun activity times and things. But all of it is focused on is focused on teaching and training them from the Bible. Every game, everything we do is all comes from the Bible, so they can learn and remember what the Bible says. And then the second ministry that I am just excited about, I can't wait until we're able to get this going at full gear, is the bus ministry. When Pastor asked if I'd be willing to do it, I had been praying about it. He had mentioned about a month back we were talking, he had mentioned that he needed someone to do the bus. So I was praying to God, and I told God, well, if Pastor asks me to do it, I'll do it. I had that laid on my heart, and sure enough, he did. And I was so excited. I had been thinking for weeks, Pastor, about just the bus ministry and about, you know, things that we could do. And I had come across this story in the Bible It's very, very familiar to most of us about. It comes from Luke chapter number 5. And it's the story of the man with the palsy and the four men that carried that man to Jesus. And the verse that I chose is kind of my focus for the bus ministry. And behold, men brought in a bed a man which was taken with a palsy, and they sought means to bring him in and to lay him before him. Here these four men saw a man with a need that couldn't get himself before Jesus, but they knew that what that man needed was Jesus. So these four men did what they could to bring this man before Jesus, and then when they got there, the room was so filled with people that they couldn't bring him in. So that's where they pulled the roof off, and they lowered this man in, and they sought the means to bring him before Jesus, because they knew that that's where that person needed to be. That person with a need needed to be where Jesus, in the house of God, where Jesus was. So in the bus ministry, we need to be seeking out needs. We need to be seeking out those in the community that have that need to come here to the house of God, whether it's that they can't financially bring themselves in, maybe it's that they don't have a child that doesn't have a family that brings them in, they can't get themselves, or maybe it's just someone that just needs that encouragement of, hey, to have someone bring them to church. And that was what in the bus ministry is all about, is going out and seeking out the people in the community that have that need, like that man with the palsy did. And then, of course, once we find those people with needs, then we provide that need by supporting them with the bus ministry and going out and picking them up. And you know, I thank God for the men that help maintain the buses and help keep those buses rolling when we have them. Brother John Hunley, I know he works hours on those buses when we've had them. But more than just going out into the community and just picking people up and bringing them to church, it's about growing a relationship with those people. For years, I went with my Uncle Vince in the bus ministry when I first started out, and for hours, we'd be out on Saturdays talking to the families of the people that would go, and just the things that he would know about their families and the things that, you know, that he would be involved in. He had a genuine care and concern for those families, and it was just such an encouragement to me to be able to see that that's what it was all about, was not just about going and getting some people on a bus and saying, hey, we had so many people on a bus, yay us, but it was having a concern for their souls and a concern for their condition that they wouldn't come to know Christ. And that's what the heart of the bus ministry is about, is not just picking up people, but to grow a relationship with people and to help them see the love of God. And I just pray that when we're able to finally get a bus and be able to go out and start picking people up, that this church will be just a beacon in the community, that people will know that God loves them and that there's a church that's willing to go out and bring them in to hear the story of how God loves them and died on a cross to save their sins, save them from their sins. Thank you.
We're going to shift gears just a little bit. You like that segue going from the bus ministry, shifting gears? You like that? Did that just for you, Brother John. You know, we have so many different areas. Some of you are saying, like, I could never teach a class. You probably could, but you're afraid to. Some can. I understand that. So I could never stand in front of a children's church and lead that. But there's some other things. One of the other ministries that we're going to talk about is our music ministry. I'm going to have Brother Bernie come in just a moment and kind of get a little of an overview of a couple things. And I'll have Brother Layton give a little bit about the choir in just a moment. But I just, as we were talking before church this morning, and as I was joking with Heather a little bit about, you know, she said I was going to sing a duet with her. And that would be special music. It'd be special. She would do well, and I would get her off key. That's what would happen. I sing in the key of me. Years ago, I was preaching in a church in Dyersburg, Tennessee. My wife already knows what story I'm going to tell. I'm sitting there on the first step. The whole family was there. And we're sitting there, and I'm preaching, and I just go tell the whole story. They did not have a pastor. I was there candidating as pastor. And this was many, many years ago. And we're sitting there in the service, and this guy gets up to sing a special. And he gets up with the guitar. And I'm okay with the guitar. That's fine. And he gets up. And he's a cute school guitar. He's going to play. And he said, now, y'all pray for us. We didn't get a chance to practice, but y'all pray. I'm like, oh, man. And so he starts doing what he said was playing. And then he started doing what they said he was going to do, sing. And that's not what I would call it. If there were dogs in the room, they'd have been howling. It was bad. And I couldn't even understand half what he was saying. I thought it was a song he'd written. That always scares me. There's a lot of people that think they're songwriters are not. He was one of those. And he was, you know, he gets done. And when he gets done, I said, amen. He said, oh, the preacher must have liked that. I'll sing another. I'm like, oh. I just wrote this one this afternoon. And he launches into another one. That had nothing to do with the Bible. I don't even know what he was trying to do. When he got done with that, I didn't say a word. I didn't say amen, nothing. I just kept my mouth shut, else he'd sing another one. That's not the kind of music ministry we're trying to have. There are times I'll call people up from the crowd to sing, but it's because they've sung many, many times. I joke with Brother Scott. If I asked him to, he would come and sing. He would. And that's fine. And many of the others have done the same thing. But our thought on the music ministry is we want our music to prepare our hearts for worship and to lift our hearts toward God. We're singing to Him, not to you. Music is a ministry, and it's spiritual. And Brother Bernie, I'd like for you to come, if you would, and just give a few comments about... I love the scripture that you chose there for the music ministry flyer. And talk a little bit about that, if you would. You need me to leave your flyer? All right, I'll leave it right there. He loves it when I do this. He's one of those I didn't tell ahead of time. Brother Bernie, come on up.
Are you going to sing for us, too?
I thought you wanted people to sign up. I love this verse because I was accused of it so much. Rejoice in the Lord, O ye righteous. For praise is comely, which means beautiful, for the upright. Sing unto them with a new song. Play skillfully with a loud noise. And I really like that last part, loud noise. And we used to play it loud for the devil, and say, hey, I want to do it loud for the Lord. Amen. And I remember I was saved when I was 16, and I started going to church, and we had one lady at the piano that was rather old and frail, and many times that she couldn't come, and so they didn't have a piano player. And being a teenager, I said, God, what's wrong with these people? Why don't they get someone to play? Good attitude, huh? And God spoke to me and says, you do it. So I knew a little bit about music. I knew what the notes were. And I asked a couple people how to play piano, and they'd show me what the notes were, and I figured it out. And I practiced 4 hours a day. I mean, six, seven, eight, 9 months. And after 6 months, I was playing piano every service. And the Lord used that. There are times when I thought, I can't play. And I remember one time where I thought, it's not going to work. My right hand doesn't work with my left hand. You don't like that illustration. They weren't working together. I mean, just nothing was going right. And I asked the Lord, if you want, you asked me to do it. I can't do it unless you bless me. And I sat down to play again, and it was just like, where did this come from?
Amen.
It came from God. And I've been privileged to serve the Lord in this capacity. And I believe there's some other people out there that, well, maybe there's something that needs to be done, and the Lord will touch your heart and say, why don't you do it? And we have a lot of opportunities as far as special music, as far as instrumentals. I'd love to hear some more instrumentals for offertories. And I'd love to hear, we got two keyboards now. I wouldn't mind three or four. And more the merrier, because, hey, we're all serving the Lord Jesus Christ, and I want to make a joyful noise unto the Lord. And that's one of the things that I think is so important. And I know you quote Ephesians chapter 5 a lot, where be filled with the Holy Spirit. And the next verse talks about speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing, making melody in your heart to the Lord. There's something about being filled with the Holy Spirit and wanting to make a new song to the Lord.
Music is important. Some of you may not be able to sing, but you can play an instrument. I love what he said when he's, you know, like, well, why don't they have a piano player? Why don't you do it? That's biblical. Scriptures, Jesus told the disciples, pray therefore the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers into the harvest. And the very next verse, he sends them into the harvest. They became the answer of their own prayer. Amen. And so areas with our special music, with the solos, with the groups, and I appreciate those that are part of that. And if God's given you some ability, we need your help there. We want you to have an opportunity to use that. And I'm just for sake of time tonight, I'm not going to have Brother Alan come up and talk about the orchestra, but we're wanting to get our orchestra started. Amen. And I know he's looking forward to that. I'm going to get the instruments out. I'm looking forward to hearing them again. Amen. And so if you have ability to play musical instruments, we have a sign-up sheet out there. And I know he's planning on doing weekly practices and some time together. And he's going to ask for some commitment about that. Why? Because we're doing this for the King. Praise the Lord for that. But Leighton, come and talk about the choir just a little bit. And I love our choir. I love hearing our choir sing. And it helps me get ready for the service. Amen? Just puts our mind in the right focus. And I appreciate Brother Leighton working so hard with the choir. I appreciate every one of you choir members. But Leighton, you talk to us about the choir.
All right, I'll try not to take too long. The choir. I mean, there's a lot of verses in the Bible that we could talk about music. The ones I pulled out for our paper that we've got in there is Colossians 3:16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And also Psalm 91:1, sing praises to the Lord which dwelleth in Zion, declare among the people his doings. Many of you are willing to sing in the shower or sing in your car.
Come on.
And you're willing to sing every place where there is no people. And I know there are times that I challenge you as we sing congregationals to sing a bit louder so that I can hear you. But why not join us up here and sing for everybody? You say, I may not have the greatest of voices. Well, we can make it better. As we practice and you get to take the time, like Pastor was saying, as we were going through practice this afternoon, you know, Bernie plays the parts and each part will sing individually, learning their part. And I'm not making an excuse for any of the current choir members and what I'm about to say. But have you ever been in a room where it's really, really quiet and one group of people starts to whisper and then another group of people over here starts to whisper? And then another group over here begins to whisper. What eventually happens? The room is full of noise, correct? And you say, I'm not really willing to sing in front of people. Well, come join the choir and sing real quietly. Okay? And you'll start out quiet, and eventually you'll build that confidence and say, I can do this. And then we'll be loud together. Remember, that is not an excuse for anyone who's currently in the choir. But if you'd come join us, I will not at all in any way, shape, or fashion claim to be the best choir director in the city of Roseville. Or anywhere for that matter. I am still greatly learning. And I mean, that I think that was apparent with today's practice. But just come, join us. And we can together declare among the people his doings, as we not only sing to give glory and honor to God, but as we prepare the hearts of those, admonishing, as teaching people what it is that the Bible says about God and how we ought to give him glory and honor.
And I picked, at the beginning here, I picked ministries that we think of. When you think ministry, you're thinking, all right, teaching a Sunday school class. You're thinking, all right, singing a special. Yep, that's ministry. Well, I've got a couple of ministries now we want to talk about. I'm going to totally change direction. But these are ministries. Brother John Hunley, come on up. I don't mind if you just read your flyer, because your flyer is awesome. I love it. I love the hat. Right tools. I appreciate this man more than he knows. He helps us in so many ways, and he directs so many things behind the scenes that helps us. Just talk about the maintenance ministry. And by the way, this is a ministry. It's a ministry. They're doing it as unto the Lord. Brother John?
Well, I don't know if pastors are going to need his rod or his staff, to rod to make sure I stay here long enough to say what I need to, or his staff to if I go too long. You know, the maintenance ministry is pretty simple. You know, we got things, you know, that are broken, need to be fixed, and then once they're fixed, we try to keep the property maintenance guys away from it. You know, the scripture that we have on our flyer is something that spoke to me many, many years ago. And, you know, basically it says, "And Judah said, the strength of the bearer of the burdens is decayed, and there is much rubbish, so that we are not able to build the wall." I'm not doing a lot, but my main thing is when I see, like, Hank Usikowski on a ladder putting bulbs in and stuff, there's things that those guys can be doing. And if all I do is replace one light, so they can do their job, then that was successful. You know, and I was talking to Bill Nightingale one time. He's like, "Oh, you know, I'd like to come out, but there's not much I can do, you know." I said, "You come out. We'll put you to work." He's got a heart. He wants to work. He came out. I found a few things for him, and he's, you know, been a blessing to us, and he's been, you know, just had a great time helping out. He just, you know, and it doesn't take a lot. You know, my wife came over here one day and just helped me ring out some circuits. She was in there flipping circuit breakers for me while I'm in the other room. There's many things that can be done. We need just a little bit of help. You know, and one other thing, you know, one time pastor came to me and asked me if I'd come up during the winter and start the buses. I'm like, sure, that'd be great. You know, and one day I came up here and and got the buses going, and it was a bad day. I forgot things. I was running late and miserable. And then one by one, the workers came in. I was late. You know, the things aren't going right. Scott was, you know, just a little bit under the weather, you know. And then later that night, pastor had him come up and give a testimony. And I forget how many kids got saved that day. And I'm sitting there thinking, pastor had preached a message on only the servants knew. None of y'all knew what people went through that morning getting up here. But thank God, all I was doing was standing in that line, starting that bus, and I got to see some stuff.
That's why we call it ministry. Because all this is not about the stuff. It's about the people that are influenced. I remember that day, brother. I remember that message. I remember that day that a lot of people had a rough day that day. But everybody did their job, and God showed up. Amen. So the maintenance ministry, if it's help with electrical, plumbing, mechanical. When we get the bus here, it'll be, you know, maintenance on that, repairs, cleaning, and just come and be a part. What a great ministry. This next one I'm going to talk about a little bit. This is a totally new one. This is one we're going to call Crosspointe Keepers. Like, what in the world is that? In Genesis 24, verse 31, it says, "Come in, for I have prepared the house." You know, we come to church, we walk in and have churches because somebody was here ahead of time getting things ready. Carpets were cleaned. Lights were turned on. classrooms were set up. The ministry of the Crosspointe Keepers is to prepare the house of the Lord so that the building is ready for the services. And here's our concept. The concept is to clean and set up the building as soon as one service is completed so that it's ready for the next service. Volunteers that sign up will be organized into teams. Each team will have a specific task. What kind of task are we talking about? We're talking about, did I bring my sheet? I did. I just got to figure out where I put it. Hold on. It's here somewhere. There it is. Things like this. In the auditorium, here's the thought. With the Crosspointe Keepers, as soon as the Sunday night church service is over, there'll be people grabbing vacuum cleaners and vacuuming the auditorium. They'll be going through, picking up the trash, putting the songbooks back in place. So that when we close the building at night, it's ready for the next church service. Soon as we're done, groups team just grab vacuum cleaners, do the things, and they'll be organized. They'll know what they need to do. They'll clean the fingerprints off the doors. They'll put away the loose items. On the platform, they'll straighten things. They'll wipe down the pulpit. They'll wipe down the pianos and the keyboards, straighten the microphone cords. Why? So when we come in for the next church service, we're not running around trying to fix all that beforehand. It also allows us that we're ready right after the end of a service. We'll do the same with the restrooms. As soon as the services are over and people start to leave, then we go through and clean the restrooms. And we've got a checklist for that. The nurseries, we're already doing some of this. We're going to do a couple extra things in there where the nurseries are completely cleaned afterwards and all the other buildings. You say, well, why do we have to do it then? Well, the way we're organizing things, we want you to be a part of that so that when you leave, whoever comes in to use that room next, whether it's for a Sunday school class or for Wednesday night for master clubs, or whether it's Friday night at a Reformers Unanimous, whether it's a Saturday morning soul-winning meeting, the building's ready. And if we do that, if we set that structure up, and there'll be folks that'll be assigned to Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, Saturday, if you've got other times, you can come in. And we need your help because we want to get this structured in such a way that if we have enough folks, each person will have just a little bit. They do their part, and then the other people are doing their part, and everything can be done. You may not be able to teach a class. You may not be able to play a musical instrument. You may not have the ability to sing. But you can push a vacuum cleaner. You can straighten songbooks. And so the Crosspointe Keepers, that's a new ministry that we're starting. And over there we've got the sign-up sheets for that. And just trying to get your concept of what we're trying to do here. We want to give people an opportunity to help us in those areas. For sake of time tonight, I'll not go through all of these. I'm not going to drag Brother Bernie back up here again. He's been afraid. He's not looking at me. He's afraid I'm going to mention. Yeah, there you go. Slide that, just like the teenagers. Sliding right down the seat. Oh, that hurt the knee. But anyway, landscaping. You know, God gave us a beautiful piece of property. We've been so blessed. I just love being able to go out of our church and see trees and gardens and not just concrete. God's been so good to us. We get to enjoy that, and it's beautiful. And our neighbors see it. And I'm just going to read what Brother Luca has on the flyer. The first impression many will have of Crosspointe Baptist Church is what they see as they pass by. And by the way, people are watching. I've had many, many people in the neighborhood say, we've noticed what you've done on the property. Even the inspectors from the city talked about how good the property looks. And we're just getting started with that. So we need some help in the gardens with the trimming and the pruning and the cleaning, weeding, mulching, watering, planting, all that kind of good stuff. With our grounds, keeping it neat and clean. And then one of the things that we're wanting to do is to construct a greenhouse. We've got this little shed right back over here that used to house animals. We're going to turn that into a greenhouse to start growing some of our own annuals that we'll plant in the spring so we don't have to buy them. Amen? And so those are just some of the thoughts with that. That's another area where you can help. And many of you are already doing that. And let me just say this. If you're already involved in one of those, we still want you to sign up. We want to get a good list of everybody's contact information, and that'll help us greatly as we go. There's just so many more things. Let me just kind of look down through the list and see which other ones we're going to talk about. Media ministry. So what does that involve? Well, John, come tell us. Remember that rod and staff he was talking about?
I can move a little quicker. I can't talk any faster, but I can move quicker. All right. So I got a couple of things I want to show you. There's a lot of, as if you've been around for any length of time, you've seen that I do a little bit of everything. If you got your Bible, go ahead and flip over to Book of Romans, chapter number 10. I'm going to read a couple of verses. And I've got a couple different things I want to show you. Our media ministry, we're kind of in flux right now. We have a lot of stuff that we were doing, a lot of stuff we want to do, and a lot of stuff we have planned for the future. And I'm going to start off real quick by telling you kind of what we've done and what we want to do and then how you can help. So we're going to start off in the Book of Romans, chapter number 10. And that's fine, you can leave right there. All right, we're going to start reading verse number 9. It says, "If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be perished. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel, for Isaiah saith, Lord, who hath believed our report? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God." One of the main purposes of the media ministry is to make sure that people can hear. And, unfortunately with the media ministry, a lot of times people don't notice us until something goes wrong. As you probably heard all the static in church this morning, or this evening, right in the middle of the service. That kind of stuff is, no one usually comes up and says, you get the PA sounded really good, we can hear everybody. It's usually, the piano's too quiet, I can't hear. So that's just one of the many things that we do. And it's very, very important to be able to hear. Just as the Bible said, if people can't hear the gospel, they can't be saved. You do have those stories of people, maybe they were given a Bible and they just felt that they were, that they needed to read it. Maybe they were given a John or Romans. And by reading the scriptures without any other influence, they were saved. That does happen. But a lot of times, people won't have the integrity listen to the nudging of the Spirit to read the scriptures. So it falls back on us to be able to tell. And us in the media ministry, what we do is just as important as when we go out soul winning, because we're helping people hear the gospel. And I have a couple of things that I want to show everybody. Just kind of what we've done. One of the things that we do, of course, is our audio and video stuff. We are quite heavily invested in that. We actually have a lot of things planned. But first off, can you flip over to our YouTube page there, Alan? First and foremost, I want to point out one of the things that we do. We have this nice projector system that that projector actually belongs to Brother Wilkerson. So whether he signed up or not for it on my sheet, he's part of our media ministry. Because he is allowing us to use that. The church doesn't have one yet. Oh, we have one, but we need to buy a new bowl for it. But this one is working, and he allowed us to mount this in here so we could use it, so that we could have our announcement slides scrolling, so we can play presentations, we can play the Grand Prix videos. I don't take that lightly at all. That is a huge help to us to be able to have that. And now it's doing this thing where it's real small. See, you only notice it when something's not going right. Give me just a second, and let me flip over to it. That's why I have it on a second screen over here. So that is some of our stats for our YouTube channel, because, of course, we We record, video record, and audio record all of our messages, and we put them up online onto YouTube. And when we started the church, when we started Crosspointe, we started a brand new YouTube channel, and so it's been up since I created it May 28th. So in the last 4 months, we've had, 687 views, estimated almost 2,800 minutes of people watching video. We've had, we have had videos watched from 11 different countries, to include the Philippines, Australia, United Kingdom, Malaysia, Dominican Republic, Singapore, Canada, Ireland, India, and Taiwan. So that's a pretty good reach. So it's kind of important because I don't know that we have any missionaries in Taiwan at the moment. But as a media ministry, as a church, we could reach out into that area. So that's one of the things you do. Can you flip over to the main channel there, Alan? So just click on the right where it says Crosspointe Baptist Church. Yeah, just click on that. We're going to attempt something. Can you click on the choir one from this morning? This is something we haven't tested yet. I know we're not supposed to do that, but we're going to try playing, see if we can get the audio to go through the PA. There we go. Can you take that full screen? There we go. Go ahead and turn it up. All right, so that's, as you know, that's our song from this morning, which I just want to play a clip of that because I thought that was quite appropriate. All of me, that's what we're asking here. We're asking to get all of you to serve. So that's just one of the things that we do. Another thing that we do is our social media outreach. Can you flip over to our YouTube page, Alan? Not YouTube, Facebook. I'm in charge of our Facebook page. And as you can see, we already have all the specials and messages from this morning are already on our Facebook page. And I know many of you use that as a tool to share to friends and family and be able to say, you know, hey, this message really touched me. Watch it. And that's what we want. We want people to be able to share that. We also have our Twitter page. Can you flip over to the Twitter page there, Alan? And scroll down a little bit. So as you can see, when I run around during services taking pictures with my phone it looks like I'm texting somebody or checking the sports scores, I'm usually not. I'm taking pictures and posting them on Twitter. Usually. But, you know, so it's just many different things that we do. Is Brian Stevenson here tonight? I don't think he made it in tonight. Brian Stevenson he's one who used to come back on the bus when he was a little kid, and about a year and a half ago, I got a message on our Antioch Facebook page saying, "Hey, I used to come to church at Antioch, and I would like to come back. Can you please send the bus by to pick me up?" Now maybe he would have found our phone number, but the way he chose to contact us was through Facebook. So we have a church member here who found us through Facebook and decided to start coming back to church. And if that's the only one that we get, I'm fine with that because we were able to reach out and help somebody. Then can you flip over to our church webpage, please, real quick? Then also we have our church webpage, and Brother Corey is working on this for us. And he updates that. This is where we're going to be putting all of our, all the different things going on. We've got a lot of plans for this. So that one's going to, I don't know if you can hang an under construction sign on that or not. But we got a lot of stuff we're going to be added to that. So some of the needs that we have as a media ministry, of course, or some of the things that we do is sound setup and operation during the services, audio recording and production, video recording and production. This is a little fun fact that most people don't know. For every 1 minute of video that you watch, there is on average 4 hours of production. So imagine the two minute Grand Prix video that I put together. I spent more than 8 hours working on that. By the time you do all of your video capture, your editing, and getting the final product, getting everything proofed, that stuff takes a while. And that's the stuff that we get to do that some people don't see, and that's something that you can help with. One of the big things that we need is a photographer for church events. As you all know, I'm in the military. I'm getting ready to go back overseas again. I will actually not be here for open house. I leave on the 18th. And I will be going overseas again. But for open house, we're going to need someone who will be able to take a camera that we have and photograph everything that's going on. Now, unfortunately, though, when you work in the media ministry, a lot of times you don't get to be a part of what's going on because you're trying to document everything. But that's important. Print publications. Everyone who, can you hold your bulletin back up again? Just hold that up. That is print publications. That took time to get together and get all the graphics together, build it in the computer, write the articles, proof everything, print it, and fold it. That stuff takes people. That doesn't just happen on its own. So that's another thing. Our weekly slides that we see up playing before the service, the projector, social media, all the different things that we do, we need help. Some of the things that we have planned to do in the future, I'm going to college for computer programming, and I'm working on a mobile application that you can have on your iPad, your iPhone, Android phone, whatever device that you have where you can have all this information just right there in one place, be able to play the messages in audio or video straight from your phone or your tablet. Down the road, we're going to have, when we start our Bible Institute back up, we're going to be recording all those classes so we can put those back online. So maybe if there's a Bible student in Taiwan who wants to learn the scriptures, we'll be able to do that for them. One of the big things that we want to be able to do is have a mobile missionary team. Because one thing that I've seen through the different missions conferences and different things over, me growing up in church, I found that a lot of times missionaries, when they've been working on the in the field for a few years or maybe a couple of decades, they come back and they've got some pictures in a slideshow. But I would like to be able to take a team of maybe 4 or 5 people to the mission field and have a full production environment there. So we'd have cameras, we'd have audio equipment, we'd have computers, be able to go there and shoot for them a video that they can take, a presentation that they can take when they come back on furlough to help raise support for them. That type of stuff is important because as a missionary, they need to be able to explain and show people what they're doing so that God can speak to the hearts of his people to be able to support them financially. And that's just some of the many things that we do, and we would love to have your help. We can always use more. I will say this, it doesn't have to be just the men. I have no problems with if I have a lady who wants to learn how to run a camera or run the soundboard or take photos. That doesn't bother me a bit. I've used my sister Sarah as a photographer before. I've used Sarah Nightingale. I had to get her a stool, but I use her for photos. I have no problem with that at all. And so if you would like to jump in and be involved with us, if you have any questions for me, just keep me at the table. Thank you.
I was thinking this morning as I came in and was enjoying the fact that we don't have a missing piece of carpet in the back of the platform. It's all patched together. We found a piece of carpet. One of the men that's been coming to our church on Sunday mornings put that down for us. You know how he found our church? He just moved to the area from Florida. Went on the web looking for a church. Found a new Baptist church being started in Roseville. Saw our website. So we had a page on there, in fact, it's still on there, that we need some help with plumbing, electrical, floor coverings. He does carpeting. He came to church because our website talked about we needed somebody to do carpet. They've been coming every Sunday since then. That's why media ministry is important. You may not see it here, but man, our messages go out. And the Sunday school lessons, the morning messages, the specials. How many countries? 11 countries. That is awesome. I mean, we've been able to take our ministry now and have now taken it worldwide. That's part of the media ministry. But John mentioned our bulletins, and want to talk a little bit about the office help. I appreciate so much Gail and Hank working in the offices, and I pile so much stuff on Gail. Where she is? Is she hiding? There you are. And I give her stuff at the last minute. She'll ask me, when's the bulletin article? It's like, yeah, we're going to have one. But this does take a lot of time. And helping with all of that, the stuff out here, so many things that were that you'll see out there that was put together in the office. And there were folks in here on Friday. She had a team of ladies and folks that were counting tracks and bundling them so we can grab them in good bundles. That's all part of the office stuff that's needed. Every week, there are things that we can use your help for just in the office. And so we're starting some new things with the next couple of weeks with our outreach. We need somebody helping us in the office, keying in all of the prayer requests, all the sign-ups. We put that in a spreadsheet. You say, why do you do that? Because we make a list of those prayer requests. We're going to pray about those. We're going to put those in a prayer list, and we're going to pray about them in church and with our men. And then also we use that to generate a mailing list that we mail to for every one of our outreaches. Well, that doesn't just magically happen. Somebody does it. And that's, we've kind of waited to at the end to talk about some of these, because these you may not think of, well, that's ministry. Oh, yes, it is. It absolutely is ministry because it's reaching people. That may not be the same as standing and teaching a Sunday school class. You may not view it as being the same as singing a special, but God uses all of those things to make the rest of that happen. I'll mention just two more. I want to mention our bookstore, and we want to do a lot more in there. I'm so excited about what we're doing in there. Having a place to get good, independent Baptist materials, stuff that's King James Bible. You don't find that at the store down by the mall. And so we want to provide things in there is where you order your copies of the CDs and those kind of things. And we've been working on that. We were able yesterday. God was so good to us. We've been fighting with getting good CD recordings without going through a lot of extra work. And yesterday, God gave us a $29 fix that fixed a problem we've had for a long time and makes it so simple. We just happened to be in the right store at the right place, and God showed us the right thing, and we asked the guys there, what about this? I think it's supposed to work like this. It's like magic. It just, I don't know how it works. We brought it back, and Brother John, it's magic. It just works. And hallelujah. And it's something we've been struggling with, how to get it to work correctly. And so our goal is by the end of a Sunday, you can get the CDs from that Sunday in the bookstore. Plan to have them there ready. I think we've gotten them now where we can master the CDs that quickly, and so praise the Lord for that. So that's kind of some of the things that we're looking at. Those are things you may not see, and we've got others, ushers and greeters, those that can help in those areas. I just want to have one more testimony, and this is for the ministry we'll be starting in November. We'll start training in December. We'll launch our RU Recovery Ministry. I'm excited about what we're doing with that. Brother Ben Burks will be with us for that first weekend. But I've asked Liz Wilkerson to come and give a testimony from a little bit different perspective. We know, most of us know what Reformers Unanimous is and what it does. Most of us automatically have the idea, well, that's, you know, that helps those that have addictions. Well, that's true. But it's way more than that. It's a ministry that helps you learn to walk with God is what it is. And I've asked Liz to come and give us a testimony of what RU Recovery has done for her. Liz, why don't you come?
Well, first off, God saved me to serve. And I wrote this down because he just told me how to do this. So as I'm thinking about it, and you know the whole background about how Richard and I felt that the Lord wanted us to be in our U. And the statement that I'm going to make says it all. God saved me from the very background of what he knows and how to use me. He saved me for me to serve him. But our U is so much more, like you said, it's so much more than an addiction program. It's a discipleship program. It's something that will teach you how to walk with the Lord on a daily basis. I wrote down a few things. For me, what our U has done for me, it has showed me how real God is. God is very real. And because I know he's real, it's taught me how to look for him in everything. We say God's in control. Do we believe God's in control? I know God's in control. I see him every day. I see him sometimes hourly. And I am for that, I sit there and say, that was something I had to learn myself. Things happen all the time. And right away we want to say, why? But you know what? It's not for the why. It's the, okay. And even though sometimes we get the why, we understand the why, sometimes we don't. We may never know. But that's okay. I'm not going to stop wanting to learn. And that's another thing. The accountability and the curriculum is phenomenal. Although Pastor has taught me oodles and oodles and oodles since he's been here too. But the RU has a curriculum set up for you to have a one-on-one time with the Lord, through journaling, through note-keeping. Now, Pastor knows I keep notes on everything. I write everything down. Sometimes he gets me confused. And the reason for this is, when a prayer gets answered, how many times do you really realize a prayer has been answered? Do you praise him when it is answered? Or does it go unknowledged, you know, unacknowledged. Through RU, I have been, when I read my Bible, I look for what I've read in the day and how the Lord will bring that to my remembrance, and he'll say something that I've read, and it's like, oh, that's why I read that. You know, how many people have done that? In taking the notes, watching what God does with each thing I learn as I obey to do it. Not only does RU teach you to have that systematic Bible study, prayer, reading, to see that God is real, to look for God in everything, it also teaches you to observe and to do. And, you know, I've been saved a long time, but I don't ever want to get to that point of arrival. I want to learn. I want to do more. RU is in my heart because that's what God saved me from. And when Rich came home and we had to go, we went through what it's all about, I just sat there and sobbed and said that, you know, God loved me. He saved me from that. And here's something that I can do to serve him with. But again, it's not just for addiction. It is if you want to have a walk with the Lord on a daily, hourly, minute basis and realize just how real he is and give him the praise due to him when he does answer your prayers, when you do learn something and then doing what he's asked you to do.
Ministry involvement. So we've heard all kinds of things tonight. We haven't talked about everything. We haven't talked about our nurseries. I mentioned them during the message. Thank God for those who work with our little babies in the nursery. Oh, I thank God for that. We need help there in all these different areas. What we're going to ask you to do in just a few minutes, we're going to pray and then we're going to head over there. I'm going to ask you to just walk through If God's been touching your heart about something, man, I'd like to get more information about that. Well, the leaders of those ministries will be there. They'll go to their tables as soon as we're dismissed. And the idea is that we want you to walk through, pick up the brochures about those ministries, sign up, and get plugged in somewhere. You know, with all the different things we have going on, there's somewhere for you to fit in. I didn't talk about our ushers, and I praise God for ushers. You don't know how much they help me. Things they watch for. These guys are, you never know what happens in a church. Different people just walk in with agendas on their mind. And sometimes the ushers, they don't just hand out things in the service. They don't just hand out bulletins and piles of tracts and those kind of things. There are a lot of things they do that you don't watch. You don't see. You don't see them when they fix problems before they're noticeable. They're part of the thing to protect us in here. They're keeping an eye on what's going on around us. Ushers, we need help with the ushers, with greeters. Just so many things. The list is out there. Please pray about it. Ask God, where would you have me serve? And then let's get plugged in there. We're going to go ahead and pray, and then we'll be dismissed. Father, thank you for loving us. Oh, thank you that in your grand design, you've got a place for each of us. None of us is here by accident. You've placed each one of us in our church. You've placed us in this place with this group of people in this city because you have a plan for us. There's a purpose. May we strive to find your purpose. May we find what it is that you have for us, and may we then be submissive to your will. May we just jump in with what you have for us. And would you teach us to walk with you in such a way that you're able to use us in those areas. Father, thank you for all of the different servants we have in this church that just want to fill a spot. They see a need, they want to fill it. Thank you that you have something for each one of us. God, thank you that you made us all different and that you have a purpose for each of us. May we together work as a church. May we strive together for the furtherance of the gospel. May you use us to make a difference. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.